What is leakage? Really, basically, it's when we have spectral content from what we're measuring that doesn't correspond to a spectral line. Let's look at an example of that. Say we've set our digital signal processing parameter such that we got 1 hertz frequency resolution, and we're measuring something that's putting out this 5 volts, 3 hertz sine wave. This was our spectral plot. What would we expect to see? Maybe something like this. 3 hertz, that's the frequency, 5 volts, and all of it being represented there. That makes sense. Now, what if we have the same delta F, still 1 hertz, but now we have frequency content at 2.5 hertz, but we do not have a line of spectral line at 2.5. So what do you think is going to happen there? Maybe something like this, 2.5
I think if you go
volts.
back one slide, it is what it'll look like.
My
Forward
goal.
one. It'll, oop, back one.
Back one.
Back again. Like that. It'll look like that because there's no spectral line. We won't see anything. This is really innovative, Charles. You know, you've
Okay.
eliminated the vibration entirely.
Yeah, that's
Am I
better than the
right?
13%. We only had 13% gain before. Now we've completely 100%
Yeah, we
attenuation.
got rid of all the noise and vibration.
I think someone's getting the raise. But unfortunately, that won't happen. The raise or making the frequency disappear. Some of us may think that, that amplitude would be split between this 2 hertz and 3 hertz because we don't have a 2.5 hertz spectral line. But that also doesn't happen. That actually wouldn't be that bad if it did happen that way. The reality is much worse. In this plot, we still have a delta F of 1 hertz, but we have frequency content at 50 hertz and 50.5 hertz. Now, what do we see? Well, with the 50.5, because we don't have a spectral line there, actually it's smearing that spectral content not across just the next two adjacent frequencies, but across this whole bandwidth, right? Across our entire bandwidth. Whereas with the 50 hertz, because we have a spectral line there, no problem, lines up. And the reason this happens is because there's a requirement with the Fourier transform, and it requires that our signal be periodic. And what I mean by that is basically it has the same points at the beginning and end. Because this Fourier transform, whether we're talking about it in the time domain or from the frequency domain perspective, it goes from negative infinity to positive infinity. And we're only measuring just a small sliver of it. We're not going to measure an infinity to infinity. So what we measure has to be periodic. It needs to be a repeating signal for us to be able to use this Fourier transform. And maybe this example we can step through here will help drive home the point of why having a periodic signal is important to avoid leakage. So this is our analog signal. And we're going to say this frame, this cap T, right, is the measurement that we have, that we sample. And if we look at it, we have the same point at the beginning as we do at the end. So if I just sample that portion of that analog signal and then just stitch it together over time, the question is this signal here that I digitized the same as this analog one? Yeah, it looks the same, right?
Yeah, looks good.
Now, what if we had a different frame? And if we look here, the question is this periodic? What was our definition? The beginning would be the same as the end. It doesn't look like that's going to be periodic. So what if we sample that? Well, if we do that and stitch it together over time, that doesn't quite look like this analog signal that we have here at the top, because we have these two points here where we have this kind of sharp transient, like almost like an impulse that's happening. So when we look at this signal, it's not the same as that at the top. And a point I want to make about that sharp transient is if you've done any work with structural dynamics and maybe you've used the impact hammer, something you probably observe or even just know, something that's really short in the time domain will have a large or a wide, I should say, a broad response in the frequency domain. So that's kind of why we get that smearing, not at just those two adjacent frequency lines that we saw, but across that entire bandwidth. It's going to have an effect across a broad frequency range, when we have this sharp impulse. So we need to remove these, right? We got to deal with this. Otherwise, we're going to have this leakage issue and won't be good. So how can we minimize leakage? Well, that's where this thing of windows comes into play. There's different types of windows. This is an example of a hanging window. So we see our signal here again, our original signal. And once again, we can see it's not periodic as we look at the ends. But what we can do is apply this window function, which is just a function that's, you can see it goes from 0 to 1. And we multiply it by our original signal and we get this windowed signal. And when we look at the windowed signal, what I really want you to focus on is what happens at the end. We see now where it was not periodic, it is periodic because we're forcing it to 0. We're multiplying by 0 here at the ends of our signal. So we get this windowed signal. And when we look at it over time, it does repeat. Now, we don't have this impulse any longer, which is a great thing. But what we do need to realize is that for a signal that's periodic, we can see that there's no leakage at all, right? No frequency smearing, nothing. One that is not periodic, tons of leakage across the entire bandwidth. We can apply a window and that improves the situation, but you can see it's not perfect. And the point in bringing this up is that if you can design your test, whatever you're doing, such that you don't need to use the window, that would be the best scenario because it's still going to have a helpful beneficial effect of reducing leakage, but it won't be perfect. And we got a demo here to kind of drive home that point a little bit more.
Okay, great. Yeah, sounds good. Do you see a 100 hertz sine wave, Charles?
I do.
Yeah, I went ahead and measured it. So I got 4 volts. Maybe I could zoom in a little bit here, go to 400 hertz or so. And you can see this is exactly 4 volts. We snap the data values, and click on the curve, and you can see 4 volts there. So that was great. I had that 100 hertz sine wave, 4 volts like we did before. I have a 2 hertz resolution. 2 hertz divides evenly into 100 hertz, so it means that sine wave lined up with a spectral line. You said if I took my nice sine wave and went halfway in between spectral lines, something bad would happen. I'd leak. Is that what you said, Charles?
Yeah, something bad will happen.
Something bad. Well, I don't know how bad it can be. I'm not sure if I believe you. So I'm going to go with 101 hertz here, and then I'm going to measure the same thing, Charles. I mean, my sine wave is pretty strong from my generator here. Okay, looks pretty nice sine there. Let me grab that and drop it in. Click on. Well, yeah, 2.54 is pretty close to 4 volts, Charles. What are you worried about? I've reduced the vibration, so it's pretty good.
Yeah.
No, so we have a bit of a problem here in that, well, again, I could talk to the motorcycle or car and say, look, I got a 2 hertz resolution. Can you just, you know, produce vibration only at 2 hertz intervals today? Kind of unlikely. The odds are you'll always have vibration or sound that's in between. And so the solution you said is to apply a window. So I can come here and put on a Hanning window, for example, and I'm still going to measure with that 2 hertz resolution. So this is 101 hertz. Now I'm going to apply a Hanning, and you say it'll be all better, Charles?
It'll be improved.
So let's see what you mean by improved here. I would say that is improved. It got up a lot higher, but it's still not perfect. It can be actually, like in this case, it's 15% off. So originally here, I can put on some annotation. I had no windows for the first 2 cases, which we call uniform, or it's another word for no window. And then I had a Hanning window here, which does not leak out as far. And here's one of the keys to kind of recovering the true amplitude. You can use a double X cursor. And a double X cursor sums up the energy because all this, nothing's lost. It's all there. It just has to be kind of summed together. And if I pick RMS, which is 0.707 of the peak value. And I'll make that font a little bit bigger for everybody. You can see that, RMS-wise, these are, well, the red and the blue, which is Hanning and uniform, are identical, right? This was the 100 hertz, then it was the 101 hertz. They're pretty much the same. The green one, which is leaked out over this infinite frequency range due to that transient that's introduced, that has the problems. I can't make the cursor big enough to go from plus or minus infinity, so I'm never capturing usually all the energy. And in practice, you know, we can live with it over a limited range, right, of leakage, because we can adjust the cursor accordingly, and we know that the frequency is there roughly, and then we got the correct amplitude. But it's hard, a lot harder to live with the unwindowed data, which could be leaked over the whole thing and smearing into adjacent frequencies, et cetera. So hopefully that made sense. Now, here's another little bit of interesting trivia. I go to the scope here. I'm going to switch back to 100 hertz. Right. I still have my Hanning window on here. And what do we expect to see in this case with 100 hertz and a Hanning window? Should it be perfect, Charles?
Actually, the Hanning window is going to still induce some effects.
Yeah. If I was to compare this, I'll just duplicate this display and we'll show just the two 100 hertz cases. Introducing a window, you see, it actually made this a bit wider, at least visually. Amplitudes are still the same from an RMS point of view, or practically the same. But a window does distort your otherwise perfect data by actually creating a little bit of leakage. Again, if we know what we're doing, we know that the leakage of a Hanning window is within a certain range, and we can recover the amplitude, and it's all good.